Then we'll jump to chapter 6 and we'll read from 6 and 7. I promise if you hold on tight this morning, it won't be too bad of a bumpy ride and I won't buck you off. Amen? Hallelujah. You don't even probably need to read or to look at Genesis 1:1 to know what it says. If you know it, say it aloud with me. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Notice that it says there, I'm not going to address that today, but notice that it says there, the heavens, plural, and the earth, singular. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis chapter 6, look quickly at several verses there. Verses 8 through 10, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God, and Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Just for posterity's sake, let's go ahead and read verses 11 and 12, and then we'll catch 13. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. I want you to understand, I'm going to pause there for just a second. And I want you to understand that when God said, I'm going to destroy them with the earth, He didn't mean along with the earth, but He meant He was going to use the earth to destroy them. Sometimes the gift that God gives us for our good becomes that which causes our ruin in the end. Bill Cloud talked about this last week on that last Sunday night. Man, you don't want to miss tonight's Bible study tonight. If you missed last week's, you're going to be just a little bit behind when you get in it, but tonight you'll be glad you didn't miss tonight. Amen? But last week he talked about how that as a parent, we give our kids toys, we give them gifts, and we give them that because we love them. We want them to be happy. We want them to be fulfilled in their life as they're growing up, right? Amen? How many of you realize that at Christmas time, there's greater joy, now that you're a parent, there's greater joy in giving a gift to your kid than ever getting anything? Amen? It really is. But sometimes the gift gets out of control in the kid's life, given the example. Quoting Brother Bill last week, he said, he would say to his child, he would say to his kids, hey, it's time for supper, wash up and come on down. And they don't respond. Don't say anything. So he raises his voice a little louder. He said, hey, it's time for supper, wash up and come on down. And still no response. And then finally, get a little bit more stern and he'd say, I said it's time to come down for supper. Now wash up and come on down. And they'll say, well, in a little while, I'm playing with my present right now. You see, what started out as a good thing became bad because now they're ignoring the voice of their father. And a lot of times in life, what becomes a good thing, and see, here's what happens. Sometimes what was given to us for our good will end up being the vehicle through which we are destroyed. And God said He was going to destroy the planet. He was going to destroy mankind and all living creatures with the planet itself. Now, you'll see how in just a minute. Going to chapter 7, verses 1 through 5 initially. The Lord said to Noah, come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Now notice some of the things that God has said about Noah. Going back into chapter 6, it says Noah is a just man. Noah was perfect or mature in his generations. It said Noah found grace in the sight of God. There had to be something different about Noah, don't you think? For this one man to have been singled out. Now, it wasn't how he dressed. Or maybe it was. Not in like length or style or color. But maybe it was the fact that he saw that there was something different about the way that those around him were acting. Maybe it wasn't about where he didn't go or did go, or maybe it was. We don't know for sure, but we know one thing for certain, that around him was evil and wickedness all the time, and yet the Bible said that he was just. I like that, don't you? It kind of stood out. He was a little bit different. You know, when everybody else is doing it and you think you need to do it because everybody else is doing it, that might be a good time to say, hey, wait a minute. Let's look at what they're doing and maybe I shouldn't do it. I heard it said one time, just because everybody's doing it doesn't make it right. There could be a convention of fools right there. Amen. Anybody ever been a part of a convention of fools before? Amen. Anybody ever ran and jumped? And you were the one that didn't make it? No? No, there's a couple of us. Between seventh grade and eighth grade, I'm following my next door neighbor down the street. There was a place in the sidewalk where the sidewalk had buckled. Some of y'all don't know anything about buckled sidewalks. Does anybody know what I'm talking about, buckled sidewalks? Anybody ever break a tire tube? So some of y'all don't even know what a tire tube is, do you? Anybody ever stub your toe on a buckled sidewalk when you was running barefooted in the summertime? See, some of y'all don't even know nothing about that. Anybody ever dumb enough to stub two toes? We lived on High Street in Mooresville. We had buckled sidewalks all the way down through there in front of us. Troy, one time I had both of my big toes was busted. Snapped the nails off them at the same. I was running like this chasing Beth and got the other one while I was hobbling. Oh, come on, don't y'all laugh at me because I know there's some more clutches in this room besides me. Was you pointing at Martha or pointing at yourself? Oh, you pointing at yourself. So there where I am. I'm following Brent down the sidewalk. We're on our way to baseball practice, and there's this place right past the dentist's office. Keep that in mind. Just past the dentist's office, not even 50 feet, the sidewalk's buckled up in a perfect ramp. He goes flying down there, hits that ramp as hard as he could go, and jumps clean across this little street there. It wasn't much wider than here to Julie. Jumps clear across and lands on the sidewalk on the other side. I've got my Schwinn Stingray that I'd sold papers for. I bought that thing brand new, Troy. Got it at Sears. Listen, you might not think it's a lot of money, but in 1968, 1969, 1970, $65 was a big wad of change. I sold a lot of newspapers to get that bike. You remember that bike, Mama? Daddy, you remember? Blue Stingray, banana seat, high-rise handlebars. Baby, I was cool as cool. Brent jumps the other side, man, here I come. I hit that puppy, and I launched even higher than he did. I'm like, yeah. What's that? There goes a tire. I wonder whose tire that is. And just about the time that that thought processed all the way through my mind was the time that my forks, minus my front tire, dug into the asphalt and launched me face first. I didn't clear the street either. I guess it was something about that tire. I lost my aerodynamics because I went straight down that front fork. Stuck. Now listen, this is not so funny that you have to snork about it. This did permanent damage. I now have two permanent false teeth here in the front from that little... You don't want to go into your dentist. I walk into my dentist's office. I can't even think of his name now, but he was right there on Indiana Avenue. That's where I always went. Had my first tooth ever that I had to have pulled there. I go in there, and then his nurse looked up, and she goes, "What happened to you?" "I had a bike wreck." The dentist runs rushing out, and he just gets hold of my lip. My upper lip was almost cut off. I mean, it was pulled out. He looks at me, and he said, "You got to go to the hospital first. You don't ever want to have somebody tell you that. You know, you go in there for help, and they say, you got to go someplace else first." I said all that to say this. It was really cool that he jumped, but it was a bad idea for me to jump. And now, do you follow me now? Has anybody ever followed somebody else like that? It didn't have to necessarily be you wrecked your bicycle and busted your front teeth out. Maybe you did something else. Maybe your buddies were cool. And here's another fool I did it to. I had older peers that were smoking. I thought it was cool. I've probably told you all this, but you know, I'm 14 years old. I was at that stage where I wasn't growing yet on the outside, but on the inside, I thought I was 10 feet tall and bulletproof. Some of my closest friends were smoking, so I hung out with them. I smoked like 3 or 4 cigarettes. I thought I was being real cool, Brother Tim. I thought I was inhaling. We got home a couple hours later, got out of the car. I had to belch. And when I belched, here came all that smoke. I wasn't even smart enough to inhale. I was swallowing it. You know what I wish? I wish that I'd been smart enough to stop there. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But I didn't. I finally learned how to inhale. And I spent the next 13 years addicted to cigarettes. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You see what I'm saying? You don't have. It can be whatever it was that you followed. Just because somebody else is doing it or a whole bunch of people are doing it, it could be that there's a whole bunch of fools right there. Everybody say, but Noah. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Evidently, there was something about him. He was just. He was perfect or mature, if you will. I'm not going to say he never made any mistakes, but evidently there was something different about this man. Amen? And so God says to him, come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen you are righteous before me in this generation. So see, we have he's just, he's perfect, and he's righteous. Now it goes through the animals that he'll take down through the next verses. And verse 5 says this, and Noah did according to all that the Lord commanded him. Jump over to verse 10. And it came to pass that after 7 days, the waters of the flood were on the earth. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month and the 17th day of the month, on that day all the fountains of the great deep were broken up, and, everybody say and, the windows of heaven were opened. And the rain was on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Lord God, please help me today. I don't want to chase too many rabbits. I don't want to get too far off track. I want to give the people what you've given me to give them today. Please help me to be a blessing. Please let your word accomplish what it's being sent forth here today to do, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, I want to take you really quick on a kind of an overview. If you went to the Creation Museum, then you're going to know some of the things that I'm going to talk about this morning. I'm going to talk about the seven seas of history. And so, if you have it there, you'll see that that's where we're going to start out. The seven seas of history. Now, I'm going to just try to cover really quickly, and I'm going to go rapid fire. So if I get a little too fast for you, then just talk to me after service. I'll be happy to provide you with my master outline that I have here, okay? I'm going to try to go fast in what we cover here today. Part of it's going to be review, then part of it's going to take us up to the end of this one point. And then over the next couple Sundays, several different people are going to fill in. We're going to have two Sundays in a row, take a break, and then the last Sunday, I think we'll be able to, or maybe it'll take two more Sundays after that. One last Sunday in November, first Sunday in December to cover these seven seas. Amen? All right, the seven seas of history. The first one we're going to talk about this morning is creation. Now, we've tried to put together a little bit of a slideshow here. So if I don't get it just right, again, I'll beg your forgiveness. But, you know, I think it'll help us from time to time if somebody would go back over for us, because we know, you know, that there were 6 days that God literally created and the seventh day he rested. Sometimes we don't always think of the things that were done in those days. So in the first sea, which is creation, we'll have this, that the first thing that was created was light. Now, notice what it says there in the Bible. It says, excuse me, that God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now, I want you to notice that what happened here was literally a dividing of the day and the night, the dark and the light, when God said, let there be light, to the point that it was so significant. And you and I would do well to understand this, because we measure our days from midnight to midnight. So basically, it's still dark for the most part when the day begins, and it's still dark when the day ends. But if you look in Genesis chapter 1 in the account of creation, God measures it just a bit different. He says, evening and morning are the day. So much so that we know that the Jews were taught, and before they've gotten things messed up too, just like we have. But for the most part, a day should start somewhere around 6 p.m. or sundown, if you will. And it should come back around then until 6 p.m. In other words, a 24-hour period, if you will. But basically, from sundown to sundown. Amen? An entire day would be going that way, rather than starting out in the middle of the night. So, I don't know how this transpired, that it took an entire day to create light. But there must have been great darkness that had to have been divided. And there must have been a great thing that had to take place, Brother Bill, for that process to take an entire day. But understand that it says there very clearly in the Bible, God said, let there be light. There was a dividing of the day and night, and he looked at it all. And when all of that was finished, he said, the evening and the morning were the first day. God saw it, and he looked at it, and he said, it's good. So on the first day, there was creation of light. On the second day, we have the creation of the atmosphere or the sky. And the Bible says that it was a firmament. Now, you just have to look up these words and study them to find out. I understand that there are a lot of archaic or old words that are used. But literally what that word firmament there means is the atmosphere, or it's literally translated as a heaven. Now, let me just tell you real quickly, because I said that earlier, and so I'm not going to try to be too heavy with you in your understanding. I don't want to get too deep in theology with you. But I want you to see something, that verse 1 of Genesis 1 says, God created the heavens. Everybody say heavens again. God created the heavens. And some people have said, you know, I heard about a church that preaches that there's several degrees of heaven. Well, there's not what you might say degrees of heaven, because some people think that when you get to heaven, that there are people that are going to have this reward and that reward, and they're going to be this and that and all that. That's not what that's talking about. The Bible tells us literally that there are three heavens. There is what we call the atmosphere over earth. That is a heaven, if you will, and that's what's being referred to here in this third or second day of creation. Then there is what we might refer to as outer space, when we break through Earth's atmosphere and we come out of gravity into the go out of this atmosphere into outer space, the galaxy, if you will, that is the second heaven. But then literally the Apostle Paul says, I knew a man who was caught up into the third heaven. And we believe that to be where God himself actually dwells. That is the place that we refer to as the home of the saints. Amen. Heaven. But you have to understand that there are going to be somebody down the road who's going to ask you, well, is there more than one heaven? And when you answer them, you need to know how to answer that. You need to say, are you talking about the sky? Are you talking about the galaxy? Are you talking about the place where God is? Amen? Understand? Now, on the second day, we have the atmosphere or the sky that is made. And my, what a beautiful thing God has done for us. Amen. On day three, there was a division. If I can get this thing to go for me. There's a division of seas and of dry land. Literally, water was over everything initially. Then there was a division of the seas and dry land. Seeds and herbs began to appear, trees and plants. All these things took place on day three. Isn't it something to behold or to think about that when a woman is first, when she first becomes pregnant, scientists refer to that combination of the sperm and the egg as a blob? If they looked at it and could just be honest about it, they would say it is without form and void. And darkness would be upon it. But that we also know that a baby, as it continues to grow in its mother's womb, it is surrounded by a fluid. It's called the amniotic fluid. When the time comes for that baby to break forth, we're told that a woman's, what happens? Her what? Her water breaks. And then there is a division that takes place, and the baby comes forth from the water. Are you following me at all? There's something going on here that God wants us to see. Amen? Now, on day four, we have the sun, the moon, the stars, and other heavenly lights that take place. And all of these, you say, well, I thought that there was to be, that the Bible said, let there be light. Can I tell you that even on the darkest night, there is still light? Even on the darkest night, if you go outside, even if there are no stars, if the moon is not shining as you could see, even on the darkest night, there is still light. Because we always say, I need to let my eyes get adjusted to the... See, some people said, I need to let my eyes get adjusted to the light. Other people said, I need to get my eyes adjusted to the dark. But either way, when they get adjusted, you find that you can still see. Now, how can you see if it's dark? Because there's still light, even when it's dark. Come on now, you still with me? So what's the purpose of the sun and the moon and the stars? Well, if you read it, you'll find that they were there to give a light. One was to rule the day, the other is to rule the night. And by the way, can I tell you something about the moon? Some of you may already know this, but do you know that the moon has no ability to generate light by itself? You know what the moon is? The moon is a reflector. The moon is a mirror. Did you know that? How many of you knew that the moon was a mirror? The moon can only shine if the sun has shone on it. You know what the church is? Church is just simply a reflector. So you know what the church's problem is today? It's trying to develop its own power, and it's trying to develop its own light, Troy, its own program, if you will, which will produce false converts that go out and shine that light. But the true church simply knows this, that it has no power of itself, it has no light of itself, it is simply a reflector, and it only can shine if the sun, S-O-N, has shone on it. I mean, I'm glad the sun has shined on your life. Amen? Amen. All right, let's move on. On day five, fish, whales. I don't know what kind of fish that is. It's a big one. It may just be that big, the camera might just be up on it. I heard a story one time about a little boy that went fishing, though. And they got back and they was telling fish stories. Everybody was talking about how big their fish was and all this. And everybody had... And the little boy said, I caught a big fish. They said, all right, how big was your fish? He said, it was about that big. And they said, son, where did you ever learn that that was a big fish? He said, it was that big between the eyes. You'll get that after a while. Day five, fish, whales. Now, isn't it kind of funny that fish and whales are mentioned specifically, and then birds? I wonder what the connection is there. I got to be honest with you. I don't know what it is. But as I study this, I found it to be fascinating the way God did things. And then check it out. On day six, oh, cover up, Adam. On day six, cattle, creeping creatures, that's just what the Bible says, and every other kind of animal that we know of, and then lastly of all, man. Isn't it kind of funny how God went about it? So on day six, for some reason, cattle or cows gets mentioned first. I guess it was important to us to know then at that time that because we weren't eating beef. How many of y'all like a good steak every now and then? Amen. How many like a nice big old burger every now and then? Amen. Hallelujah. I know I'm preaching long today, so you guys are probably thinking, man, I wish he'd stop talking about food. But you know what? When we're talking about this right here, Adam and the cows were eating the same thing. Grass, herbs. I went down to North Carolina a few years back and I met Dr. Malkmus. He's the founder of Hallelujah Acres. About 30-something years ago, diagnosed with a baseball-sized malignant tumor in his colon. His mother had just 3 months before died of colon cancer. He wasn't sure if it was the cancer or the chemo and the radiation that killed her. He said, I'm not going to go that route. I'm going to go and I'm going to start eating vegetables and drinking vegetable pure juice. In a year's time, he had lost about 40 pounds. All of his physical problems had cleared away. And the last time he checked with the doctor, they went in, scoped him, x-ray, everything they could find, the tumor was gone. Completely healed of cancer. So I was talking with him because I was going through some physical issues at the time. And I was asking him, I said, what do you say to people who say you have to get protein? You've got to, in order to get protein, you've got to eat meat of some kind. And I asked him, I said, what do you say to people like that? And he said, what kind of meat do they say you ought to eat? And I said, well, like beef and, stuff like that. And he said, well, where does beef get its protein? Do cows eat other cows? I'm like, no. He said, well, where does a cow get its protein? I said, well, it eats grass and green. He said, I'm eating green leafy things, right? And I was like, yeah. He said, so why can't you just go and eat green leafy things and get the same protein for yourself that the cow's getting? Could it be that God showed us through creation that we don't have to have the steak to be healthy? Now, if you like the steak because you like it, then that's cool because the curse has been lifted off of that. I mean, because of the curse, we're carnivores now. Do you understand what I'm saying? The cow and the human back then ate the same thing, and the human and the cow did just fine. It's not until later when we introduce sin into the equation that we find that the cow's not doing so good anymore because we're eating him, and the only thing he gets to do every now and then is kick our bucket over. That's another story to that one. I want to give you a thought here. Well, let's do this. Day number 7 was the Sabbath. Everybody say Sabbath. The Sabbath was a rest day. Now, I included this so that you'll understand that when you look at your calendar, and you will know that even the calendar today still marks creation as God made it, with Sunday being the first day of the week, or day number 1, and Saturday being day number 7. Everybody say day number 7. And on the 7th day, God rested. Saturday, not Sunday. I want to give you one last thought, and that is this. Notice, only man was created in the image of God. All else was created to reproduce itself. What I mean by that, if you look along the Genesis account of creation, you'll see that it said every seed bearing kind of itself. Cattle reproducing after its own kind. Only in the human being, only in the human species, the human race, do we find. I'm not talking about the color of skin. I'm not talking about nationality. Only in humans do we find that humans, same sex, try to mate and think that that's right in the sight of God. Animals do not try to create homosexual relationships. The plants do not try to create opposite of what God intended. Are you following me? Everything was created by God for a purpose. And like I said last Sunday, there are things that are in your DNA. There are ways that women respond to certain things that men say or do. And guys are wondering, why on earth did she respond that way? Because it's in her DNA. She expects it was placed there from Eve from the very beginning. And it was carried all the way on down. All right? So now we've covered creation, kind of an overview. Let's go to this. Corruption. Everybody say corruption. Corruption. What do you think of when you think of the word corruption? Trouble, sin, what else? Politics. Amen. Amen. Politics. Let's talk about politics for just a second. You know, politics actually is a multiple, it's actually a couple words been put together. One of them comes from an old Greek, poly, P-O-L-Y, which means many. Tick, living out here in the country, we all know what ticks are, they're bloodsuckers. Politics really literally means many bloodsuckers. Amen. Now, I don't know what persuasion you are, but amen. Corruption, sin, the fall. You see, here's what you have to understand. Before sin entered into the world, not so much as even a fly ever got smashed on the wall. Because at that point in time, flies didn't bother anybody. Amen? There were no bees that would sting you. There were no snakes that would bite you. There were no lions that would chase you down and attack you, because lions in that day and time, they ate grass. They could, and you know, thank God someday, the Bible says, and I'm about to preach somebody else's sermon, but the Bible says that in the 1,000-year millennial reign that is soon to come, we pray, that a lion and a cow, although you all think it's a lamb, but it's a lion and a cow, or a calf, they'll lay down beside each other and eat grass. They'll eat hay together. There's coming a day. Creation right now is groaning for God to put it back right. Lions and tigers, that's why they're so grumpy and they growl and they snarl, because they're eating that meat, but that's not what they want. They just don't realize they'd like a good clump of hay followed by a nice drink of water. Listen, sin and the fall of man literally affected everything until the day comes when Jesus Christ puts it back right again. So we have corruption, the sin, the fall. Then we have shame. Remember, Adam and Eve realized they were naked and they ran and hid themselves. Then we have separation. You see, they could not stay in the garden. There was a deadly danger if they stayed in the garden, because what they didn't realize, and evidently Satan himself didn't even realize this, but not only was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was there, but the tree of life was already there. And some people say that God was so mean and that God was so awful and God was so hurtful that He put them out of the garden. I'll get to that in just a second. But I want to tell you how good God really was. God was so good that He put them out of the garden before they could find the tree of life and eat of the tree of life and then been forever condemned to being in a lost and fallen state. Amen? That's good. That's a good God. Amen? Now, then we have sweat. Everybody say sweat. Anybody else in the room sweating besides me right now? It's hot in here, isn't it? Amen. I was afraid to turn on the air conditioner, afraid the ladies would stone me. I saw a bunch of y'all sitting in your jackets, and you're like this. Penny, me and the kids, we used to go down on Memorial Day weekend and spend Saturday night at her grandma's house. And one Sunday morning, we woke up, me and Casey and Whitney, sweat running off of us. I got out of bed. I walked in there in the living room. I looked at the thermostat. It was 85 degrees in that house. And Penny and her grandma was running around. And they both had on sweats and their furry little, silly little bunny house shoes. And they were just like little bugs in a rug. They were fine. We're walking around sweating. Y'all know that sweat is a curse? Did you realize that? How many of you guys and gals have to get up tomorrow morning and go to work? Somebody have to go to work tonight, probably. Amen. How many would rather not have to go to work? Do you realize that working, having to go out and slave to provide a living, do you realize that that's part of the curse? Did you know that? Because of sin in the fall and the shame that it brought and the separation that followed where they were kicked out of the garden, where they could, all they had to do was go over and pluck it off of a tree. Contrary to some of you kids, money no longer grows on a tree. Now, if any of you parents have a money tree, please let me know, because some of us would like to get some of your seed and plant one in our backyard. Amen? No, here's what happened. The sin and fall, shame and separation, and then God said to Adam, now, by the sweat of your brow, you're going to make your living. Every time you do that, every time you go, boy, it's hot. Just think of Adam. And just say this, Adam, it's a good thing for you when I get to heaven. Because when I walk in them gates, I'm going to be sanctified, because if I wasn't, I'd kick you right in the shin. Amen? I got to go on. All right. Now we have catastrophe. Here's where we're going to bring it. Here's where we're going to wrap it up today. Catastrophe. What do you think of when you think of catastrophe? Disaster? What are some famous disasters that you and I know of recently that have happened besides the last election? I'm sorry. That's one of those things that jump out there, isn't it? A tsunami? Christmas Day 2004? How many hundred thousand? Over 200,000 people died. Have any of y'all ever seen any actual live video footage of that? I've seen it. We actually have it in one of the messenger songs that we play. There's a clip in it. Well, the video that we use, it shows a clip of that. But I've actually seen live footage where people were standing. They walked out. See, just before the tsunami hit, every time, this is a scientific fact, before a tsunami comes, the ocean will actually withdraw like a massive low tide. People were walking out there and watching the fish that got caught unaware that were flopping on the sand. And I've seen footage where people were from here to the road, probably from where the beach would normally been. And they were just walking on sand. And all of a sudden, they don't even hear it coming. And then you see this massive wave come from behind. And it's just, it's a dirty, dark, horrible-looking wave. And it just, and you can just about be 100% sure that you just watched every person that wave caught. You just watched those people die. What about on 9/11? I sat with two other brothers in horror and watched as people jumped. Those little specks. At first I didn't realize what it was. Then a reporter said, folks, he said, that's not debris. That's people who are jumping from the building. Can I tell you? Not one of those people survived. You and I watched as countless firefighters ran into those buildings and many of them never came back out. The story is told of a man who came here from England. It might have been Ireland. But during Vietnam, he won high awards in Vietnam for heroism. Was highly decorated. And he survived multiple Purple Heart injuries in Vietnam in combat. Ran back into that building to try to save some people he knew were in there, and he didn't survive that one. Troy, Leandra, who else in the room was with us the first year we went down in 2006, right after Katrina? It was just the three of us that are here today. Heather and Amy, I think, were the only other two. Dave knows a little bit about Katrina. Deb knows a little bit about it. Y'all know a little bit about it. Family right there in St. Bernard Parish. How did I say it? St. Bernard? We've stayed there at a Dulham Fellowship just around the corner from where Dave's mother lived. We walked around, sometimes couldn't even speak. Saw Sam's Club warehouse. All that was left was some emblems on the front to let you know this is what it was. The side, the metal frame was still standing, but the entire building and roof, you saw that, swept away, gone. We had a little bit of a taste one afternoon. Everybody say afternoon. About 2 or 3 hours of Hurricane Ike blowed through here. We have a tornado comes past. And yeah, it's rough, it's bad, but it's here and it's gone in seconds. These people had to endure over 100 mile an hour winds for hours. Our pastor down there told us, you know the one I'm talking about, Adulam, I can't think of his name now. Little brother, Pastor Randy, told us that on the day after, they had 5 inches of water standing, and in a matter of minutes, they went to like 8 to 10 feet. Youth pastor was swept out of the building. If it wasn't for the railroad cars and the railroad switching yard directly across the street from the church, where he was swept over to, the rescue boat plucked him off the top of one of those cars. That's how high the water was, and it swept him across through there. Actually, he thought he was going to die, but that actually ended up being what saved his life. We traveled those streets. We were in the lower Ninth Ward and other places that we went. Folks, I want to tell you something. You can say whatever you want to say about George Bush, but if you can picture an area probably 3 to 4 times larger than the city of Louisville, entirely the Jefferson County, being underwater, and tell me how you're going to respond to that correctly. I would like to know how you can say it. I'm not saying they did right. I'm just saying who to know how to handle a disaster area the size of the state of Texas. Till you see it with your own eyes, you've never been there. Amen? We looked at buildings where it told that there were people in those houses that did not make it out alive. Now you think about that. And you think about catastrophe. There are other events that have been just as horrific. Amen. I've been to Pearl Harbor. There in Honolulu. We didn't get to go because of the crowds. We didn't get to go out and look at the ships. But I've stood there. And I know my dad. I would love to be able to take my dad there someday. Because I know my dad, being a Navy, a veteran of the Korean War. I know that he would feel great solidarity. Yesterday, I couldn't explain to Casey, but as we drove through Fort Knox, and those guys in their gear, they were in full combat gear, and they were on those ranges, and they were shooting. We stopped to let a couple of guys go over across the street. I told Casey, I said, I can't tell you what I feel in my heart right now for those guys. They're getting ready to go do something that most of us in this room can't or won't do. A lot of people watching can't or won't, and I feel us all there, and I can just imagine what my dad would feel. The cowardice and the enmity that takes to sneak up on an enemy and attack them when they're not even knowing that they're at war and kill over 2,000 of our boys and our girls down there in Pearl Harbor. That's a catastrophe that touches lives and changes them for forever. I mean, I could just go on and on, but are you getting the picture of what catastrophe is? You see, here's what catastrophe also can be. Catastrophe can be a car wreck that takes the life of somebody you love. Or a sudden heart attack that comes. Or catastrophe can be she has leukemia. You understand? Do you know where we put the blame? See, most of the time people are quick to say, what kind of a God lets this happen? Instead of saying, God, this devil, I can't wait until he gets what's coming to him. I wrote a song. It went on our second Messenger album. You'll just have to know the day I wrote it, what was going through my mind that day. But I wrote a song called, You're Gonna Get What's Coming to You. And I can't wait until you do. Amen. I would trade whatever rewards, I would trade whatever mansion, whatever glory I have, Troy, to get to be sitting somewhere in the first 100 rows whenever he is dragged by that chain up to the feet of Jesus, and he is made by those angels to bow down and confess that Jesus Christ is King of Kings and he is Lord of Lords, and then be there front row when one of those, I don't know which one's going to be, takes that foot and puts it in his behind and sends him where he's never going to come back again from forever. I want to be there. Amen. You say, well, that's silly. Well, just indulge me for a while. I just kind of feel this today. Amen. Anybody else? Anybody else like to be front row and watch him get it? If not, there'll come a day when you would like to be there. Catastrophe. Well, what causes catastrophe? In this case, everybody say this case, so that you don't misunderstand what I'm about to say. In this case, this catastrophe is caused by, first of all, evil thinking. Somebody said one time, it's our stinking thinking that gets us messed up. Amen? Stinking thinking. Evil thinking, what do you mean? You see, here's what I know. You put junk in, eventually you're going to get junk out. Every person who's ever been or has viewed pornography will tell you, pornography is not about what you saw today. It's what you can still see tomorrow, next day, and the next day, the next day, and years down the road. Every man in the room that knows what I'm talking about, say amen. It's the truth. Now, you can say, well, I'm not going to admit to that, but I'm telling you, admit to it or not, it's the truth. It's wicked. Can I tell you? Downstairs somewhere, don't ask me where it's at, but downstairs somewhere, in, let's just say an archive, I have a videotape of Dr. James Dobson interviewing Ted Bundy. Have y'all ever heard of Ted Bundy? Mass killer of women. Incredibly corrupt person. Now, a lot of people say it's not possible, but Ted Bundy gave his life to the Lord before he was executed. And if he truly gave his life to the Lord, I believe someday we're going to see Ted Bundy in heaven. And you know what's going to be amazing? We're going to see Ted Bundy in heaven, maybe, and not see some people we thought would be there. And then realize all of a sudden, it's just a good thing I'm here. But here's what Ted Bundy said when he was a young boy. He found a penthouse magazine that somebody had stashed, some grown-up had stashed. And he started down that road looking at penthouse magazine. He said, well, I never. You know what? Sin can take you further than you ever wanted to go or ever thought you would go. How many in the room know that I'm telling you the truth? How many right now would say, I have done things I never dreamed I would ever do? I really have, preacher. You say, well, what I did wasn't that bad. Well, how bad does bad have to be before bad is bad? You see, it doesn't matter how bad you might think your sin is sin in the sight of God, and we need to stop quantifying sin and just say, look, if it is wrong, it's wrong. You see, the person who hasn't really done anything all that bad but never gets right with God is going to end up in the same hell as Adolf Hitler is. Amen? Evil thinking got them started down the course to this. Evil actions. You see, I've never known anybody who just went out and did something that they never thought of beforehand. They may not have thought about it long, but a thought has to enter your mind before you ever do something. I mean, if I walk down here and hit Caitlin right now, I'm not going to. Should I? Okay. I asked her, should I? She said no, but her cousin said yes. Maybe you should talk to Lisa. But if I hit her right now and then said, I don't even know what happened. I never even thought about doing it. How many of you would think, come on. All right? That's the same thing God does. When you and I do something, then we go, oh, I didn't mean to do that. See, you don't ever do anything, even though we say, I did that without thinking. Because it's not possible. Everybody say, it's not possible. It's not possible for a member of your body to do something without the command first coming from the brain to go do it. Honey, it don't work that way. That car out there in the parking lot is not going to start until I put the key in the ignition and turn it. Amen? Evil thinking leads to evil actions, which leads to awful consequences. I wish that I could paint a prettier picture for you today than what I have about this. But I want to tell you, if your stinking thinking leads you to evil actions, eventually you're going to suffer horrible consequences. That's just how it goes. Hear me carefully. The Bible says you reap what you sow. Amen? One preacher preached a sermon. It was entitled, Payday Someday. You might not get punished for it right now. You might think you might fool me. You might fool Troy. You might fool your parents. You might fool your wife. You might fool your spouse. You might fool the whole world. But the Word of God says that someday we will stand before God and we will give an account for our actions, our deeds on this earth. And when we do, what will be the story that is told at the end? Hear me carefully. I don't know about you, but this is what I once said. He has not been perfect. He has not always done right, but we believe He has done the best He could. But wait a minute. There came a day right there when Jesus Christ came into His life and every sin He ever committed was washed away. We don't have a record on this guy. Now, I know the devil would like to step up and say, now, wait a minute, Your Honor. But if that scene should happen, it's not going to. But if that scene should happen, but wait a minute, Your Honor, I object. His Honor is going to say, overruled, you fool. I don't care what you say, there's no record here against this man, against this woman. You might say they were yours. But I have a title and a deed here. It says they were bought with the blood of Jesus Christ, my Son. Now get out of my face. These belong to me. How many are glad that your sins have been forgiven? How many are glad that your name has been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life? How many are glad today that Jesus Christ represents you? You know, some days I'm not so sure how glad He is that I represent Him. But I sure am glad today to stand and say I'm glad He represents me. I'm going to stop right there. You can pick up the others in the weeks to come. There'll be a little bit more of an outline, I have no doubt about it. But there are four more C's to come. Those of you who have been to Creation Museum, you know how to go ahead and fill it in. That's your prerogative. Let me ask you to stand with me this morning. Every head bowed, every eye closed, no one looking around. Do your best. Do your best to stay reverent with me this morning. I feel the presence of the Lord here today. Several times I have felt Him wanting to break through upon us, and I believe He is. I believe He is. Mark, I want you to come up and just begin to play me something softly. All righty. Now here we are. I want everybody to stay where you're at now. Stay in the presence of the Lord. All right. Heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. How many in the room this morning say, Pastor, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. I love Him. I'm not ashamed of Him. I'm glad He's mine. I'm His. Would you shoot your hand up and say, I love Him this morning. He's mine. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. You can take your hands down. Let me just ask you this question. Is there anybody here this morning that would say, Pastor? And listen, I want you to understand something. When I ask you this question, I don't want you to be afraid or think I'm trying to point you out, because I'm glad somebody asked me one day. A lot of people tried to help me, and I love them for it. But I'm forever grateful for John Piercy one day, who wouldn't let me talk about my problems. He wanted to talk to me about my problem. My problem was I did not know Jesus Christ. I was lost and undone. I want to talk to you this morning. Maybe you're watching via the internet. You say to me, Preacher, this morning things are not right between me and God. I am not where I ought to be. I am not a Christian. When I ask you that question right now and you get a chance to respond, I want you to know you don't have to be ashamed. You don't have to be afraid. Nobody's coming to get you. Nobody's coming to point you out. This is a question that every one of us in this room were asked at one time or another. And every one of us got a chance to respond. And I just want to give you a chance this morning. Saints, if you would be praying right now. Is there anybody here this morning say, Pastor, I'm not a Christian. I want you all to pray for me. Anybody at all? Lift your hand this morning. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Several raise their hands. You can slip your hand back down. Anybody else? Anybody else? Let me just do this. Saints, I want you to pray right now because the power of God is moving right now. Let me ask you this. If you were one of the ones that raised your hand, would you be willing to do something about it? If I'd help you this morning, if we would help you this morning, do you want to do something about it? If you would you just look up here at me and just nod your head yes? Say, yes, sir, I would. Amen. God bless you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anyone else that raised their hand? I'm going to pray a prayer in just a minute. And I'm going to ask the congregation, I'm going to ask everybody, including those of you who said, I want to do something about it. I'm going to ask you to pray with me. We're going to pray together. Brothers and sisters, let's help somebody come into the kingdom of God this morning. Amen. Pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, I know that I'm a sinner. I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. I ask you to come into my heart and save me. With your help, from this day forward, I will live for you. Thank you for saving me today. Now let me ask you a question. While our heads are still bowed, eyes still closed. If you prayed that prayer with me this morning and from your heart, today you ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins and to save you today, would you look up here at me and nod your head and let me know you prayed it with me? Amen. God bless you. Brothers and sisters, two new brothers and sisters brought into the kingdom of heaven today. Amen. I want you to know today that right now in heaven, there's a celebration right now taking place. God is being honored. And I'll tell you what else is being honored here. What else is being honored here is a brother and sister that came into this church sometime back and they received Christ. And they've gone out and shared Him now. And now two more have been added to the kingdom of God. Isn't that awesome this morning? Amen. Now let me ask you this. Those of you that know this morning, you say, Pastor, I know that I'm saved. But I'm struggling with some issues. I'm battling some things right now. I need some prayer. Anybody like that this morning? Anybody like that? Here's what I want you to do right now. I want you to come. And I want you to come and let's kneel on this altar this morning. Come on, let's do it this morning. Let's just seek the face of the Lord. Amen. Come on. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I want everybody that's kneeling to have somebody behind them. You can simply put a hand on their shoulder. You can kneel beside them and put an arm around them. I don't care how you do it. But I've got a couple people over here. I've got one brother on this end down here who needs somebody behind him. A couple on this side over here. Come on. Come on, it won't matter if there's a couple. Amen. The Lord's speaking to your heart, brother. Come. Amen. 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 Bless him. Amen. Bless him. Bless him. Hallelujah. Lord, I bless your name today. Lord, I thank you that you are the God who hears. You are the God who answers a prayer. Lord, your ear is not deaf. Your arm is not short. You have not gone out of power. Your glory still prevails, Lord God. You are still our healer. You are still our provider. You, God, are still our banner over us. Lord, you are still our peace. You are still our shepherd. You are still the God. You are still the God who helps us and who heals us. Lord God, today I pray in Jesus' name. Lord, I ask you right now that you would reach down your hand upon these your servants today. And I pray, God, that you would begin to work and minister and move in their lives. Pam, I need you to come right over here beside Casey and Kenneth. Dave, would you please come? Amen. Is there anybody else who works in the school system? Amen. Go ahead, just get in here. Amen. Don't y'all, y'all just help us pray here this morning. I happen to know that these are battling right now. I know that these three, especially, I don't know how it's going to miss Pam, I don't know how it's going for you, sis, but I just ask you right now. Lord, I pray that you would help these that work in these schools. God, I pray that you would strengthen them. Lord, you see the battle that they're facing because of the culture. You see the battle that they're facing because, Lord, of regulations that are placed upon them, God. Lord, you see the battle that is placed because the enemy is trying to keep them from shining a light in the darkness, to keep them distracted, to keep them afraid, and to keep them dismayed, and sometimes to keep them angry. But right now, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, I just pray that you would help my daughter-in-law. And God, I pray you would help my son. Lord, I pray you would help my sister and my brother, my sister, old